Hi, my name is Shashank Mehra, and today we will be discussing two forms of market anarchism, namely anarcho-capitalism and agorism. And now, to be clear, I'm using these terms as their founders intended. So when I say anarcho-capitalism, I mean Rothbardian anarcho-capitalism. Many anarcho-capitalists today have abandoned political methods, but it wasn't always true, so don't get offended if I make some criticism. And when I say agorism, I'm referring to the term as Konkin used it, and we will be concentrating more particularly on the conflict between Rothbard and Konkin, and the roots of that conflict, which lies in the basic difference between these ideologies. These ideologies are relatively new, so I will ask you to forgive me if I am misrepresent anyone, and I am open to corrections. In the Rothbard-Konkin debate, I am usually leaning towards Konkin, so forgive me if that reflects in my presentation. The flags that you see, the four flags, are all various ideologies that are related in some way or the other to the phrase market anarchism. The first flag is, of course, the flag.
I can't see the flags.
Can you see it now?
Yeah, the presentation is visible.
Okay.
Yeah, now it's visible. Yeah.
I think the presentation is not working. Anyway, so the first flag is that of market anarchism. It's usually the flag that is used everywhere, the yellow and black flag. The second is the agorist flag, which is the gray and black flag, which signifies their concentration on black and gray markets. Third is mutualism. We will not be talking about it because they come from slightly different tradition and they are a bit diverse and complicated in itself, so it's a bit outside our scope. And the fourth is the last flag is the now capitalist flag, which is the black and yellow flag. If you notice that I have drawn the market anarchism flag and the anarcho-capitalist flag as completely reverse of each other. This is this idea I got from a Reddit user who said that he made his students draw the flags in reverse to signify that these ideologies are not the same, not exactly the same, that market anarchism and anarcho-capitalism are a bit different and in some way reverse of each other. At that point, I did not fully understand what is the meaning or what he means by these are in some ways reverse of each other, but it's a bit more clearer with the Rothbard-Konkin debate, and it will become clearer even more later on. So first we must understand what is Rothbardian anarcho-capitalism. Wendy McElroy, who is a present-day individualist anarchist and individualist feminist, she writes, Rothbard took three traditions, three themes, which were considered antagonistic to each other, and wove them together to produce the philosophy that dominates the modern individualist anarchism. She's of course talking about anarcho-capitalism, and she lists these three traditions as individualist anarchism, Austrian economics, and the old rights policy of isolationism. Now, I don't like to use the term isolationism, so I use non-interventionism, because isolationism sounds like, can easily be confused like North Korea's isolationism, which is not what Rothbard advocates. So Rothbard himself never wanted to title his ideology as individualist anarchism, and he wrote an entire article on it where he pointed out and respected the difference between himself and Benjamin Tucker, who was the 19th century unofficial spokesperson for individualist anarchism. What Rothbard did was he took individualist anarchism and he pruned it of all its bad economics, mainly the economics that originates from Adam Smith's free market defense surrounding labor theory of value. He replaced the labor theory of value-based defense of free markets and replaced it with the Austrian defense of free markets. And this was something that was entirely new. And the more you read Rothbard, the more you realize that Austrian economics and individualist anarchism were sort of made for each other. So he used to say anarchism is the fullest expression of capitalism, and capitalism is the fullest expression of anarchism. If you want to read the Wendy McElroy's article, I just quote it. I will share it on chat and put it later in the description. Okay, so as for agorism, I found basically three uses of the term, and all of these uses are closely related to each other. In the first usage, agorism is an ideology which asserts that free markets that libertarians wish to achieve exist in the real world in the form of black markets. It maintains that state has no legitimacy starting now, and it refuses all reformism in all forms. Second usage is to describe left Rothbardianism, which is a result of Rothbard trying to form an alliance with the new left in the late 1960s. Rothbard eventually had to abandon the alliance when Marxists eventually took over, but he spent enough time on the left to influence thinkers, one of whom was Samuel Edward Konkin III, who is the founder of agorism. A good summary of left Rothbardianist views is written by the mutualist writer Kevin Carson. I'll share the links if anyone wants to read. Many left Rothbardians hold the belief that in a free market, wage labor would be replaced by agoric relations, under which instead of corporations, there will be large groups of entrepreneurs rated by trade and not by authority. Each person sells basically what he produces, the contractual arrangements, but not his time. Basically, wage labor, left Rothbardians believe that in a free market, wage labor will be minimized. Like, take this quote from the New Libertarian Manifesto, which is written by Konkin, and he writes that in an agorist society, division of labor and self-respect for each worker capitalist entrepreneur will probably eliminate the traditional business organization, especially the corporate hierarchy and imitation of the state and not the market. Most companies will be associations of independent contractors, consultants, and many other companies. Many may just be one entrepreneur and all his services, computers, suppliers, and customers. This mode of operation is already around and growing in the freer segments of Western economies. The third use is when people say I'm doing agorism, which is a wrong usage. If you read the New Libertarian Manifesto, you will see that Konkin writes agorism our goal. There's one section, and then there's a section counter economics our tactics. So the correct phrase is that if you're involved in gray or black market activity, the correct phrase is saying that I'm doing counter economics and not I'm doing agorism. Apart from their preference to agoric relations, agorists have the same goal as anarcho-capitalists, yet we will see later that they can be opposites to each other when it comes to tactics. So before I go further, does anyone have like any questions related to these ideologies if I have not explained them clearly? Anybody there? Okay. Yes, so I will move forward. Before we move forward, let me clarify some terms used by agorists, because when anarcho-capitalists use the agorist read the agorist literature for the first time, they are surprised by how the language that you use, and especially when they call themselves of the left. So even though they are the same tradition, anarcho-capitalist use of the term might some be so some terms of agorists are inherited from the pro-market left rather than the pro-market right, from where the anarcho-capitalists inherited the terms. So as I said, an agorism was born out of Rothbard trying to influence the new left. Konkin and other agorists claim their position on the left because they consider their origins to be on the left. In the French Assembly, where left and right originated, the free marketer Frederick Bastiat sat next to the mutualist anarchist Proudhon on the left. Bastiat was not a mass market anarchist, but his intellectual heir, Gustave Molinari, I'm sure I'm pronouncing all these names wrong. So he was the first market anarchist in the recent history. The distinguishing feature of a market anarchist is, against a liberal, is that his final rejection of state solution to security in favor of private security. And Molinari was the first person, at least in recent history, to suggest private defense in his article, Production of Security. So Sam Konkin, so for Sam Konkin, libertarianism is a philosophy of not just left, but far left. Even Rothbard tries to correct this historical mistake in his article, Left, Right, and the Prospects of Liberty. However, within the libertarian movement, within the libertarian circles, Konkin tries to use the term left libertarians and right libertarians. Quite specifically, he considers libertarians to be of the think tanks and policy-making institutes as right libertarians because even though they believe in liberty, they choose to work with the state. Left libertarians, for Konkin, were people who rejected the state outright and did not accept any policy by the illegitimate entity like the state. Konkin considered Rothbard to be a centrist libertarian. Rothbard was open to all tactics to eliminate the state, which ranged from working within the confines of the state, while it is possible, and to outright civil disobedience when the state was no longer reformable. There's a reason why Konkin makes the left-right distinction like that, because, as I mentioned, the tactics of anarcho-capitalists and agorists can even be against each other. So let's talk about why that is so, and how can two people who agree on the end result, economics and libertarianism, disagree on about almost every policy prescription for the state? For once we understand why this is, we will be able to better appreciate the Rothbard-Konkin debate. What you see here are the five markets that exist. The immoral moral distinction in this diagram is according to the non-aggression principle. The white market is the state-approved market. This is what the mainstream always cares for, basically. All of our economic indexes, measures are from this white market. All market activities in the white market are state-approved. Gray markets have otherwise moral activities which are not approved by the state unless they are done in accordance with the state. It also includes gray areas where the state regulations have not caught up. Black markets are moral activities, basically moral according to the non-aggression principle, which have been outright banned by the state, like drug dealing, prostitution, and weapons trade. These do not break the non-aggression principle, but the state still bans them because of various political or religious reasons. This doesn't mean that there isn't any violence outside the state, which is where the red market comes in. These are immoral acts and the state disapproves of murder, theft, slavery, and of course they are state approved also immoral acts like war, taxation, torture, imprisonment, and compulsory education. Now, Konkan did not use many of these terms. This diagram was made by some other online agorists. So he only talked about black and white markets, which is where we will be concentrating. But this visual aid helps us understand the conflict in our in tactics. White market is where the state derives its income from. The taxed business is what funds the state. And the state, in turn, provides violent tactical support to certain businesses. Strategy of anarcho-capitalists has been to legalize as many voluntary acts as possible, which would increase the size of the white market. If minimum wage was to be increased, more and more workers would become part of the. If minimum wage was to be decreased. More and more workers would become part of the white market as they wouldn't have to hide their employment anymore. Similarly, if illegal immigrants were allowed to take jobs in the white market, there would be an increase in the size of the white market because more and more workers will be legally joining the white market, paying their taxes because they don't want to hide from the police. But here lies our dilemma. If the state derives its funds from the white market, wouldn't increasing the size of the white market increase the state's earning, make it easier for it to spend on wars, support status infrastructure, and distort market through its spending and welfare? It does, and our capitalists countered that by aiming to eliminate taxes altogether, and their tactics do this through political parties and movements. The whole Ron Paul movement was exactly that, and it did not work. There's a reason it did not work. Try to see what we are doing this and what this tactic is. Basically, we have a statist cat in front of this. We have the statist cat, and in front of this cat, we put an enlarged bowl of white market milk, and then we say to the cat, "Don't drink from it." This is exactly what we are doing. We are increasing the size of the white market, and we are asking the state not to tax it. So of course the state cannot increase the size increase the taxes too high, otherwise the opportunity cost of evading the tax would become low. If the taxes are too high, even the most obedient citizens would try to wiggle their way out of when their survival is at stake. But if you increase the size of the taxable market, you partly solve the problem for them. Now they have more produce to tax without increasing the tax burden on the rest of the white market. Basically, what I'm saying is that the free market policy making for the state ends up making the state more efficient. It makes our white markets more efficient, which makes our measured white market economy boom, and the state is able to extract more revenue from it. The fact that free markets work ends up working for the state and against the principle of liberty. So Konkin had just a minute. So Konkin had a different strategy. He sees that the white market is the revenue stream of the state, so we must starve it. To starve it, he proposes that we must encourage more and more people to take part in voluntary market activities outside the state. Build communities without approval of the state. We must basically all the voluntary acts that are disapproved by the state. We must impart libertarian economics teaching to people already in the black market. Basically, he wishes to increase the overlap of people who are both libertarian and black marketeers. And he outlines the various stages of the movement that may come about. The state will become especially vicious, like a parasite who realizes that the host is trying to kill him. If this fall of state is to come, it would be because the state is inefficient, not because the state is efficient. So you can see why there is this huge divide. Using Konkin's term, right libertarians join political parties, think tanks, and other status institutions to improve the functioning of the state. They help the state trim their operation, making the white market more and more efficient and more productive. Right libertarians want to legalize as many things as possible so that more and more people from the black market are able to enter the white market. Whereas Konkinite left libertarians want more and more people to exit the white market and move their operations in the untaxed black market. this is the conflict of taxes with tactics which puts them at odds with each other. All the right libertarian policies end up being counter-revolutionary and work against all the agorist tactics. If you read the novel Alongside Night, character Dr. Vreeland has been created as a mixture of various free market economists like Friedman and Rothbard, and in the end Vreeland had to pick a side, whether he wishes to continue aligning with the state to reform it or whether to align with the revolutionary agorist cadre. The American currency was about to fall and the European Union demanded that Dr. Vreeland be made in charge and in exchange for supporting the new US currency. At that point in the story, signifies the opposing nature of the taxes. Had Dr. Vreeland accepted the offer to freely reform the state near its death, the state would have survived longer, prolonging the suffering. I won't spoil it further. I hope that people read the political thriller. So with this, the first part of the presentation is over. I'll take a break for 5 minutes. If anyone has any questions, please feel free to ask. And then we'll go into the actual Rothbard-Konkin debate. Any questions? Hey, Mithun, sir, Sven, can't you hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. So I had muted my mic. So if no one has any questions, I'll move on with the Rothbard-Konkin debate. Okay, so now let us turn to actual points of disagreement between Rothbard and Konkin, and then I will give my perspective on it. As we discussed, Konkin criticized wage labor as something to be remnant of the feudal system. I guess he imagined that the free market would replicate how the black market is organized. In the black market, we see independent contractors exchanging their products rather than exchanging their labor for wages. So an extension of that system would probably lead to an organizations of contractors who would be joined together by their goals and not just exchanging labor for money. So Rothbard rejects this presumption. Austrian economics shows us how wage labor has been a boon to the poorer sections of society by allowing them to receive their wages today in anticipation of their profits later on. While the production is taking place, the capitalist does not earn anything. The wage earner, on the other hand, receives his wages almost instantly and therefore can spend on getting goods that he needs today. So according to Rothbard, wage labor is a concept that is not unlibertarian because it is voluntary. Konkin's reply to this is a bit more detailed because I see this as an uphill battle for Konkin. Rothbard even calls into question Konkin's credentials as an Austrian economist because Konkin suggests that wage labor might be obsolete in the future. Konkin points out that the wage labor has many inefficiencies involved. He points out three things. Firstly, the wage labor is getting increasingly obsolete as more and more menial tasks are being automated. Secondly, he points out that wage labor is detrimental psychologically, as one is selling one's labor to the direction and authority of another. Thirdly, he points out that profitability of wage labor is always open to question. As people start saving, they would start thinking of investing. Lastly, Konkin points out that this is an empirical question, which is for economic historians to analyze rather than economists. So his credentials as an Austrian economist should not come into question. He's simply making an historical observation. And while the invention of wage labor has been beneficial, there is no reason why entrepreneurialization cannot change this landscape. Which brings us to their differences on the existence of entrepreneurs. The question that is related to wage labor. Konkin says Rothbard is not delving deep enough into the mysterious existence of entrepreneurs, and that if he did, he would find that entrepreneurs can indeed be made, a process that he called entrepreneurialization. He also points out that in a free market, the production of entrepreneurs would be a profitable activity. Konkin also points out that Rothbard would agree that our society needs more entrepreneurs. Indeed, the success of a society depends on the outcome of entrepreneurial activity. So why does Rothbard criticize Konkin's idea of creating more and more entrepreneurs? Rothbard brought up this topic because, to him, the idea of libertarians becoming counter-economic was laughable, as there is no proof that libertarians make better entrepreneurs, and that he accuses New Libertarian Manifesto of making this assumption. To which Konkin replies that if entrepreneurs cannot be made, there are already a ton of counter-economic entrepreneurs who vastly outnumber libertarians. These are already well-established, and they need only a libertarian insight to make them agorist. So the idea that entrepreneurs cannot be made has little effect on agorist tactics. So I must admit that my own knee-jerk reaction was that Konkin is wrong and Rothbard is right. That was until I read Konkin's rebuttal, because there are a lot of left libertarians out there who just criticize wage labor, but their criticism is based on their labor theory of value. Konkin does not base it on that. So I think Konkin is mixing, but I still think Konkin is mixing two roles in his argument, one that of capitalist and the other that of an entrepreneur. Even if it is true that entrepreneurs can be made, they do not replace capitalists. In fact, an entrepreneur need not be capitalist. He can, in fact, borrow money from a capitalist and direct production and give back with interest to the capitalist while making a profit for himself, profit or loss. The role of that a capitalist plays in the market is that he allows people with shorter time preference to get goods in the present while they are producing for the future. Which such a benefit of capitalism will not simply vanish in a free society. As for psychological dependency on the boss that Konkin talks about, that workers have developed over the years of feudalism and statism, I think that is a cultural issue which is indeed a remnant of the past regime. Workers should indeed be free from the feudal mindset that they have some inherent duty to serve a certain class of people. But isn't self-responsibility and self-dependency already a part of libertarian culture? I think we just need to promote that. However, I also think that the problem has been exaggerated by corporatism and banking mafia. If the banking institutions have money monopoly, they are able to direct the flow of capital away from potential capitalists in the hands of the few. So there definitely will be more equitable distribution of capital goods, and the existence of capitalists will be dictated by the markets rather than the state. But I cannot agree that wage labor will vanish completely. That I don't think will happen. On the other hand, I think Konkin is right in trying to delve into why entrepreneurs exist. It seems to me that Rothbard has avoided this question, and if entrepreneurs can be made, there is no reason to think why their production cannot be market activity. Indeed, you will find that there are certain local cultures that have a higher concentration of entrepreneurs and risk takers. In India, baniyas are popular for their entrepreneurship. So, like, how does this happen? If it is indeed linked to culture, then it is also linked to upbringing and the training of children in that culture. So I think Konkin is right about entrepreneurship and Rothbard is right about capitalist and wage labor. Those two are different topics. Just a minute. Any questions till now? Okay, so next in the debate, Rothbard says that the idea of black markets taking over white is impossible because black markets lack scale. He points out that black markets are only able to flourish in commodities that are small and easily concealed, like drugs and gold. Who will make automobiles, steel, and cement? All those things need to be done right under the nose of the state. Rothbard accuses new libertarians of ignoring the white market activities which are not possible in the black market. So Konkin replies that they do not ignore the white market and they plan to bring white market activities into the black market. And he gives a huge list of large-scale industries that are operating in the black market already. And it is a huge list of black market activities which you should read. Rothbard was only looking at the tip of the iceberg. It is only the visible black market that he sees. He sees only the 1% of the economy as black market and not the 20 to 40% of the economy the IRS sees as underground. And the double of that to make up the whole counter economy, which the IRS ignores as irrelevant to taxation. Next point, Konkin points out that black markets are already involved in large-scale production in countries such as Burma and India. Burma is almost 100% black market, and these black economies need just a libertarian understanding to remove the parasites of the society. So here I completely agree with Konkin. Black markets are indeed capable of providing the same goods that are in the white market, but it depends on the organizational alliances and the libertarian movement on the whole. So Shikha asks a question about why black markets are not violent. Okay, so yeah, I'll speak on that. So first of all, there is no guarantee. Yes, indeed, black markets do have violent elements in them. But a lot of these violent elements that you see are sometimes just defending themselves against the invasion of the state. So if you consider taxation to be inherently illegal, then you will see that if someone is trying to raid your operation because you did not pay taxes, in such a situation, if someone tries to defend themselves, state will brand them as violent elements of the economy and state will try to take them down. That is obviously true, but as a libertarian, we do not just give a blank check to the state and say that whatever you're doing is right. So violence is not the element we should be looking at, because violence can be both initiatory violence and defensive violence. We should be looking at who is initiating the violence. And if there's an element in the black market that is initiating violence, then Of course, that is wrong, that is bad, and that should be taken care of. But that is not what is inherent to the black market. Black market, what is inherent to the black market is their denial of the state their cut, basically the taxes. Does that answer the question, or should I go like deeper? Yeah, in pre-1991 era, yes, we had a lot more black market activity before legalization and the so-called liberalization. So yeah, we already had like a lot of good people in the black market, and it certainly wasn't violent. There were doctors who were operating their clinics from home. They are not violent. They are not paying their taxes. They are not reporting whatever they are earning. They are not the violent elements that we are talking about. So we had a lot of good people in the black market back then. But you see, as in when the state almost crashed in 1991, and then they came up with legalization so that they could increase their basically pot to take from. Anything else? So Rothbard then accuses Konkin of having no appeal for the working wage earners, which is surprising because that is exactly what Rothbard is accused of, unjustifiably of course, but Rothbard is usually the one being accused that you don't have any concern for the working class. But he's accusing Konkin of exactly the same thing because he sees that while it is easier for a person who is self-employed or who is operating a small business, while it is easier for him to lie about his earnings and avoid taxes wherever he can, it is not easier for a wage earner, and I can concur with that, because all your taxes that are coming in, they're already deducted at source, and you get the deducted income. So it is exponentially difficult for a working class person to basically avoid paying taxes, which is what libertarians keep pointing out, but for some reason we are against the working class interest. Anyway, so he asks what of the plumbers, mechanics, carpenters, wielders, drivers, farm workers, pilots, actors, accountants, engineers, technicians, lab assistants, computer programmers, and just key punch operators, nurses, and so on and so forth. So Konkin says that all of the people in this list that he was listing out are at least 20% counter-economic, and many are over 50%. If they do not take the first step by becoming independent contractors there towards economic liberty, then their employer does. And he points out various ways in which the employers of these people try to wiggle their way out of paying taxes and basically to keep the earnings amongst themselves. Here I think Konkin is missing the point. Rothbard is talking about the disgruntled and dissatisfied employees in the white market who cannot be counter-economic, especially those who have their taxes deducted automatically. It is indeed true that employers have a higher ability to avoid taxes, but it is certainly possible for working class to escape taxes too, as Konkin points out. And as the scale of black markets increase with time, more and more of these disgruntled employees of the white market, they will look for opportunities in the black market. In fact, I think that in some ways, Konkin has more to say to the working class than Rothbard. While Rothbard imparts understanding of economics, I think Konkin's strategy is better suited for the working class. Indeed, self-employment has been one of the strategies of the old anti-state left. Which brings me to the other strategies of old anti-state left, which could only be slightly modified to work towards agorist goals. There's active work being done on it, but that's for the other time. And Rothbard, next point that Rothbard says is that counter-economists have almost nothing new to gain from learning about libertarianism because they're already counter-economic. It would be like promoting ducks to swim. But Konkin says that I think, and I think he's right here, that his own personal experience with counter-economics has been much better. Imagine living in a society which considers your counter-economic activities as immoral or evil just because the state says it is. Then imagine that a theoretician out of the blue tells you that that you're not only is your activities moral, they are revolutionary. I think if you are able to convince them, it would be a great boon from them. They'll be freed from the guilt of operating in the black market, because today most of the black marketeers think of themselves as being temporarily in the black market. They wish to be absorbed into the white market again as soon as possible. So they aren't there in the black market out of their free will. They are there because the state has literally left no avenues for them to survive. If they don't take part in the black market, they will basically die of hunger. But they have to do all of that just to survive. But they also wish at the same time to enter the white market as soon as possible. So this is the kind of guilt that is induced through culture, through education and everything. By the state, you see the advertisements every day, pay or taxes, and all those advertisements, all of them contribute and creating that guilt environment, which I think libertarians are the only one who can rid the counter-economists of. Okay, so I'm leaving out that portion of debate that deals with Libertarian Party and Koch brothers. I think it has more to do with politics than the libertarian theory and economics. So basically, Rothbard accuses Konkin of being too much critical of Koch brothers, he accuses him that just because he's a rich multimillionaire, Konkin and others on the left have a problem with people being rich. That's the kind of accusation he makes. But Konkin defends it by saying that he has in his circle a lot of other millionaires, maybe not as rich as Koch, but he doesn't hate them. The problem with Koch that he has is not that Koch is a millionaire, but the problem he has is that he advocates for policies that are specifically suited for political ends rather than agorist ends. So, basically that says, yeah, screen is black because I switched to this main screen. There are no more slides, so that's all there was. And Rothbard basically defends political action. He says that voting is something that we should do because if the state is saying that if state is stupid enough to give us choice every 5 years, then we should exercise that choice. And to which Konkin rebuts and says that for the state, votes are profits and that way state states is able to justify its actions, and therefore Konkin rejects voting. I think it's a matter of opinion. The important point to take is that Rothbard, as I understood, like most of his life, used political means towards anti-political ends. So like he talks about how if we could through political action, remove this tax deduction from source, it would be easier for working class people to evade taxes and come out of poverty. And Rothbard wanted to use political means to do that, but to achieve more liberty, basically. Right libertarians, on the other hand, use political means for political ends. And That's why Konkin made a distinction between right libertarians and Rothbard. He used to call Rothbard and those in his inner circle as centrist libertarians, or like basically moderates who were neither completely left nor completely right. Konkin wanted to use anti-political means for anti-political ends. He wanted politics to basically the idea of some people governing other people to be eradicated, and he wanted to use anti-political means for that. And as for the political methods that Rothbard advocated, Konkin replied by saying that since when did the state repeal anything from corn laws to suburban property tax unless it had authority to maintain that law? First comes the counter-economic scaffolding, then mass civil disobedience, and then the threat of insurrection, and only then repeal. Votes are profits for the political party, and party is an organ of the state whose overt purpose is to vie for control of the state, and whose covert one is to co-opt, support, the sanction of the victim. So with this, I end this debate. I hope this was informative. I did not want to take much sides, but I think it's clear I took some sides in the debate and gave my own opinion on it.